Ladies and gentlemen, and fellow educators, imagine a classroom where virtual reality transports students to the streets of ancient Rome, where artificial intelligence provides tailored tutoring to the needs of each student, and where global collaboration happens at the click of a button. Now, picture a world where screen addiction is rampant, and where students struggle to concentrate among a sea of digital distractions, and where, unfortunately, the replaceable human touch in education is slowly fading away. First and foremost, technology has the power to democratize learning. Through online platforms and open educational resources, education is no longer confined to the privileged few. A child in a remote village can now access lectures from a world-renowned professor. A working adult can now pursue a degree without having to sacrifice their job. This democratization in learning is perhaps one of the most significant inventions and advancements in education since the invention of the printing press. But let's pause this utopian or maybe dystopian vision and ask, are we confusing progress with chimera? Are these intriguing apps and sleek devices truly enhancing learning? Or are they simply digital sugar pills, masking deeper potential damage at the very roots of education, and therefore education as a whole, which would pave the way for a regression? Critics of the digital new world point to shortened attention spans, the death of critical thinking, and the rise of a generation addicted to instant gratification. In our rush to digitize, have we forgotten the value of the teacher's guiding hand, the joy of losing oneself in a book, the satisfaction of solving a problem with the simple use of our mind, a pen, and a sheet of paper? Couldn't it be that those old tools, at first glance, so simple, are instead very important when it comes to the learning process? And besides what concerns the educational journey, as we push technology, are we leaving behind those who can't afford the latest gadgets, creating therefore a new class of second-class students? Here's where it gets truly mind-blowing. In our pursuit for innovative education, we find ourselves circling back to the old method, the Socratic method. Peer learning, hands-on experimentation. In some instances, these past learning methods are being revalued and reproposed as revolutionary educational learning systems. Speaking of handwriting, let's put our digital discourse aside for a moment and focus on the apparently simple pen and paper. Neuroscientists have discovered a fascinating connection between our brains and our hands. When we put pen to paper, we're not just forming letters. We're forging neural pathways, creating new connections and new synapses. Who can recall the many times that our parents or our teachers at home made us copy down 20, if not 50 times something by hand in order to learn it by heart? Isn't it a well-renowned technique, one to write summaries when we want to learn a lesson? The physical act of handwriting is connected to our brains in ways that typing simply can't match. The difference between the two actions is the same difference seen between painting a landscape and ringing a doorbell. Handwriting is like a full body workout for our gray matter. It sparks creativity, it enhances memory, it deepens comprehension and forces concentration. Another example is the involvement of the mirror neurons. Those neurons are the ones involved in the process of acquiring information through mimicking the example shown. This osmosis learning process, this learning through example, is one of the most significant pillars of education for us human beings, which includes also the presence of human teachers. But in our classrooms, especially when it comes to home assignments, the scratch of the pen on paper has been replaced by the clatter of keyboards. We've gained speed, but at what cost? Are we raising a generation of poor thinkers but quick typists? Have we sacrificed understanding for efficiency? I believe we did, and I'm not the only one. While we've been rushing ahead into our digital future, one country has had the courage to slow down and take a U-turn. I'm talking about Sweden, long celebrated as a beacon of progressive education. Swedish students are considered as top students in Europe and not only. For a decade, Sweden embraced technology with open arms in its classrooms. Tablets replaced textbooks, and apps substituted assignments, while typing was championed over handwriting. It was a very bold experiment, and it was watched both internationally and nationally by educators. Even though the outcome was expected to be a higher IQ, given that through technological education, students did gain easier and more access to educational resources, shockingly, Sweden students witnessed a troubling trend. Student performance declined and the IQs began to drop. This was reported by the International Association for the Evaluation of Educational Achievement. The digital natives weren't thriving, they were floundering. Sweden is now doing the unthinkable. They're bringing back handwriting and traditional old methods. They're currently relegating tablets to a supportive role rather than the star of the educational show. This isn't at all a nostalgic move. It is instead a data-driven decision. A recognition that sometimes progress means when to know when to take a step back, because not always newest is synonymous with better. Also, Sweden's educational U-turn forces us to confront an uncomfortable question. In our rush to digitize, have we been running in the wrong direction? The truth is that we're standing at a pivotal moment in front of crossroads, and the path that we will choose will shape not just our youngest generation, but the future of the entire education as a whole, and especially the foundation of our society, which is based on varying experiences. While AI can grade essays and provide instant feedback, it cannot replace the nuanced intelligence and emotional intelligence of a human teacher. Can we use digital tools to enhance rather than replace old traditional methods? Can we learn how to use these tools, maintaining human connection and creativity? The answer lies neither in blind adoption nor in stubborn resistance, but in the wise and thoughtful integration. We must combine the best of both worlds. We can welcome the power of technology while keeping the irreplaceable human instruction in education. We can create classrooms where tablets and textbooks coexist, where students type on keyboards and craft essays by hand. As we implement technology in education, we must also be careful about maintaining the human connection. Blended learning approaches, which combine the best of technology and face-to-face instruction, often yield the best results. We should use technology to enhance, rather than replace, meaningful human interactions in the learning process. The future of education is written by us, in the choices we make today. Will we allow ourselves to be swept away by the digital tsunami, or will we be able to combine both tradition and innovation. The choice and the power is ours. Thank you.